Hello everyone and welcome back to PerioHub. I'm Dr. Sneha and today we're going to discuss about periodontal microbiology. So the fundamental aspects of microbiology has been discussed in the previous broadcast and we'll take that as a base to discuss the microorganisms associated with periodontal disease. So let's get started. So periodontal diseases are basically polymicrobial diseases. They are multifactorial in nature and there are many host factors which are involved to determine whether the individual is susceptible to the disease or not. So what do we understand by this? First of all, let's discuss the aspect of polymicrobial nature. So that means that periodontal disease is not caused by a single microorganism. It is a group of microorganisms which, when present in the plaque sample, can cause the periodontal disease initiation and progression. The second aspect here is the multifactorial nature. That means there are certain intrinsic as well as extrinsic factors like smoking, dietary substances that influence the progression of periodontal disease. And the third aspect, which is one of the most important aspect, is the host factors. Now, certain individuals are susceptible to the periodontal disease, whereas certain individuals are not. So if a person is not susceptible and still there are presence of microorganisms, the host is able to neutralize these microorganisms and in that case, periodontal disease does not occur. So the host susceptibility is very important for disease initiation and progression. So today we are concentrating on the polymicrobial nature of periodontal disease and we'll discuss the various microorganisms associated with the disease. So there are about 600 bacterial species that can be colonized on the dental surfaces. Now, are all these microorganisms associated with the disease? Obviously not. Now, majority of these organisms are commensals. That means they are seen in healthy individuals as well. And only a small percentage of bacterial strains which have been identified through clinical and experimental evidences. So only these small percentage of bacterial strains are associated with gingival tissue inflammation and underlining bone destruction. And these bacterial strains are termed as the periodontal pathogens. So remember, periodontal pathogens are a small minority of microorganisms which can cause gingival inflammation and bone destruction. Now, most of these periodontal microorganisms, if we see the nature of these microorganisms, they are anaerobic in nature and they can also be facultative anaerobes or microaerophiles. Now, these terms have been discussed in the previous broadcast. I'll link the video somewhere on the screen so that you can check that out. Now, how exactly do we know that certain microorganisms are associated with a particular disease? So, way back in 1882 and 1883, it was Robert Couch who did an experimental study and came out with the Couch postulates. So basically, Robert Couch was studying two diseases. One is tuberculosis and the other is cholera. So according to these postulates, if a certain microorganism fulfills these postulates, that means that microorganism can cause the particular disease. Now cholera, for example, is only caused by one single bacteria, that is Vibrio cholera. But in case of periodontitis, it is a polymicrobial disease. And for this reason, Sigmund Sokransky, somewhere in the year 1977-79, modified the Couch postulates into Sokransky's postulates, which are specific for periodontal disease. So let's see these postulates. So the first one is association. So this means that the pathogen has to be found in increased frequency or increased number in disease state. So that means if there is periodontal disease, then there would be increased amount of periodontal pathogens. The second postulate is elimination. So the treatment will reduce both the number of the microorganisms as well as cause disease elimination. The third postulate is host response. Now this basically means that the microorganism will cause certain tissue destruction and further it will elicit the host to release certain antibodies against the microorganism. So the host has to release certain antibodies against that specific microorganism. The fourth postulate is the virulence factor. Now, it means that the pathogenic microorganism should be able to release certain virulence factors in form of endotoxins or exotoxins, or it can be certain organelles associated with the bacteria itself, such as fimbriae and flagella. And these virulence factors should demonstrate the damage of the host tissue. The last postulate are animal studies. Now, this basically means that if the organism is isolated from a periodontal subject and it is inoculated in an animal, say a mice, then the mice has to develop periodontal disease. So it should be able to produce disease in an animal model. So now over years, it has been seen that Sokransky's postulates are not 100% true. There are certain drawbacks which are associated. For example, 100% elimination of any periodontal pathogen is impossible. So any treatment that we do cannot eliminate microorganisms which are present deep into periodontal pocket. Now many of the microorganisms are also indigenous commensals. So they are present in healthy state as well. So the term elimination or complete elimination does not really hold good in periodontal diseases. Again, one more important point here is animal studies. It has been seen through experimental studies that animal models show varied degrees of success. So if Porphyromonas gingivalis is inoculated in the mouse, certain mice did develop periodontal disease, whereas others did not. So stating that each and every time the animal model has to be successful in demonstrating the disease is not quite possible with periodontal conditions. Now, one more very important contribution by Sigmund Sokransky is the fact that he gave us complexes. Now, he examined almost 13,000 subgingival plaque samples from 185 subjects. And he did cluster analysis and he was able to group them into 6 very closely associated group of bacterial species. So let's discuss these complexes or these groups of bacteria. So firstly, talking about actinomycetes. So this species is not exactly grouped under one complex. Coming on to the base of the pyramid, we can see 3 major colors over here, the purple, the green and the yellow. So they basically form the primary colonizers. So remember, the base of the pyramid is formed by the primary colonizers. The yellow complex bacteria are the Streptococcus species, be it Streptococcus mutans, Streptococcus mutans, Streptococcus oralis, etc. The purple complex is occupied by Vionella parvula and Actinomyces odontolyticus, and the green complex bacteria are the Capnocytophaga species, the Aggregatibacter Actinomycetes comitans serotype A, whereas the serotype B falls under the purple group, and the Echinella corridens. So these are the primary colonizers. Now we have spoken about the primary colonizers in the video where we spoke about plaque, and I'll again link the video somewhere on the screen. Now let's talk about the secondary colonizers, which occupy the upper half of the pyramid, that is the orange and the red complex bacteria. So the bacteria which falls under orange complex are the Campylobacter species, the Fusobacterium nucleatum and the Provotella intermedia, whereas the red complex bacteria appear later in the biofilm formation. So they fall under the secondary or the tertiary colonizers. They are associated with the periodontal destruction as well as with bleeding on probing. And the bacteria which fall under this category are the Bacterias forsythis or Tenerella forsythia, Porphyromonas gingivalis and Treponema denticola. So if we take into account this particular diagram, here we see a deep periodontal pocket, and the tooth associated bacteria are always the primary colonizers. So they are the ones which are occupying the base of the triangle, the purple, the green and the yellow complex bacteria, whereas the bacteria which are associated with the epithelium or the tissue are the secondary or the tertiary colonizers. So these are the bacteria which are mainly associated with the periodontal destruction. So first, the epithelium is invaded by these bacteria. They enter into the connective tissue and ultimately cause connective tissue destruction and destruction of the bone as well. Now the whole process of periodontal destruction is quite complex and we'll come to that later. But for now, just remember that the secondary colonizers or the red complex bacteria are mainly tissue associated bacteria which further cause tissue destruction and associated with bleeding on probing. Now let's talk about the different bacteria that we see in different conditions. First, talking about health. So in case of a healthy oral cavity, we mainly predominantly see gram-positive cocci like the Streptococcus species, Streptococcus aureus, Mitius, etc. or the gram-positive rods and filaments, for example, the actinomycete species. Now, in very, very less quantity, we might see certain gram-negative cocci as well, for example, the Vionella species. Now, coming on to gingivitis state, now here we see inflammation of the gingiva, wherein there are equal proportions of gram-positive and gram-negative. So, almost 56% are gram-positive, that is Streptococcus, actinomycetes, and almost 44% are gram-negative, such as the Vionella or Provotella intermedia species. Now, there is a category called as pregnancy gingivitis. So, because of the increase in the hormones and the steroidal content in the body, pregnant women can have a condition called as pregnancy gingivitis. Now, the major organism associated with pregnancy gingivitis is Provotella intermedia. Now, in case of chronic periodontitis, the organisms which are seen are mostly gram-negative, anaerobic, capnophiles. Now, capnophiles are organisms which thrive in presence of carbon dioxide. So, mostly we see the orange and the red complex bacteria. So, we can see Porphyromonas gingivalis, Aggregatibacter actinomycetes comitans, there is presence of Tenarella forsythia, Provotella intermedia, certain spirochetes can also be seen. Now, experimental studies have also seen the presence of certain viruses, the herpes virus, such as the Epstein-Barr virus and the human cytomegalovirus. So, moving on to aggressive periodontitis, similar to chronic periodontitis, we see increased proportions of gram-negative anaerobic capnophiles. Now, aggressive periodontitis can be of two types. We can have the localized forms. Now, in this, 90% of the cultivable microflora is of AA, that is Aggregatibacter actinomycetes comitans. Now, talking about the generalized aggressive periodontitis, here the dominant species that we see are mainly Aggregatibacter actinomycetes comitans, PG, that is Porphyromonas gingivalis, Provotella intermedia, and again certain viruses such as the human cytomegalovirus can also be isolated. Coming on to peri-implant conditions, so these are conditions wherein there is inflammation of the soft tissue associated with the implant along with destruction of the alveolar bone. Now, very similar to chronic periodontitis, even peri-implantitis has the gram-negative anaerobic capnophiles which are dominantly seen. So again, all the orange and the red complex bacteria are seen in abundance. So to quickly summarize, in case of health, we saw how our oral cavity was predominantly associated with gram-positive cocci and filaments. And slowly in case of gingivitis, there is a shift in the microflora which is seen. So here we see equal proportions of gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. Now, after this stage, there can be an overgrowth of periodontal pathogens that can occur. Now, if the host is not able to contain the disease, then it leads to the destruction of the supporting structures, leading to the periodontitis condition. Whereas on the other hand, if the host is able to contain the disease, then it remains at a gingivitis state. So this is a broad overview of the different types of periodontal pathogens seen in different conditions. And we also saw that how the host factors come into play in determining whether periodontal disease will occur or not. So with this, we come to an end of this particular video and I hope you found it helpful. And if you like this video, then please subscribe, like, comment and share this video with your friends and colleagues. And I'll meet you very soon with my next video. And until we meet next, take good care of yourself. This is PerioHub signing off.